Good afternoon to all. Today we are going to discuss about the main whitening test and t-test. Possibly we'll be covering the conceptual aspect and the calculation of both tests. And moreover, we'll also discuss how to test the null hypothesis by using u-test and t-test. Let me share slide. Dear friends, we discussed about the concept of non-parametric test and criteria for their use in the context of research data analysis. We are continuing the discussion on the same topic. Yesterday, we covered the Wilcoxon test, and today we are focusing more on U-test. This is also called main whitening test. Yeah, main whitening test is basically used in unrelated research design, having two independent samples, or you can say having two independent data sets. And the independent variable for the use of main whitening test should be one, and obviously there should be two experimental conditions. Two data sets have come from the two independent samples. As I told you earlier, the level of measurement of independent variables should be ordinal whenever you will start using non-parametric test, whether it may be Wilcoxon, main whitening, it doesn't matter. The basic difference between Wilcoxon and U-test is in the research design. If the research design is repeated one, we have to apply Wilcoxon test. But if the research design is unrelated, independent, we have to use the main whitening test. Let's go ahead and let's see an example to be more clear about the main whitening test. See, this is the research hypothesis related to a case where we can use main whitening test for data analysis. Okay, this is the research problem. First, you be focused on the research problem. One group of participants was given a relevant title before reading a text. A second group of participants was given no title before reading the text. Participant and both groups were tested for their memory of the test. The results are shown in table 7.4. This is the sample data. Obviously, it includes two independent conditions, 1 and 2. And here we have generated the data on memorizing capacity. And the condition 1 is In condition one, the participants were given no title before reading the text, but in condition two, the participants were given relevant title before reading the text. And our main concern is to compare the difference between two memory scores. under condition 1 and condition 2. And for this research problem, this is the research hypothesis. A group of participants were given a relevant title before learning the test would recall the text better than a group of participants given no title. And obviously, this is the directional research hypothesis. When you will look at the table to check whether the computed value is significant or not, you have to look at the level of significance in one tell form. That is the one thing you have to note hereby. Let's go ahead. These are the memory scores under condition 1 and under condition 2. See, one thing is very important to understand and differentiate in case of U test. See, the number of participants between condition 1 and condition 2 is different. Just you look at the condition 1, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 participants. There are 6 participants under condition 1 and 8 participants under condition 2. So, the number of participants between two independent groups may be different, but in case of relative design, in case of Wilcoxon test, the design is always repeated. So, the number of participants in condition 1 and condition 2 is always equal. But in case of U test, beginning the independent sample T test, the number of participants under condition 1 and condition 2 may be different, may be equal. Right? So, let's go ahead. How to calculate the U value? Yesterday, just I have said the idea of ranking in case of U test 2. There are 6 scores under condition 1 and 8 scores under condition 2. You have to merge the all scores and have to generate the one data set and then should go for ranking. It is not like the case of Wilcoxon test. In Wilcoxon test, we create the difference between the scores of two conditions and go for ranking for the differences. But here, we are merging the all data points of condition 1 and condition 2 to make a single data set, and then we'll assign the ranks for that. Just you look at here, how to go for ranking. If we'll merge the scores of condition 1 and condition 2, then what will be the smallest score? Just to look at here, I think 2 is the smallest one. And we have to give 1 rank for this 2 and 2 rank for this 2. And this is the tied rank. And you have to compute the average of 1 and 2. 1 plus 2 by 2 is equal to 1.2. This is the procedure of ranking. And the rank goes up to 14 at maximum, right? And just you compute the sum of rank for condition 1 and for condition 2. The sum of the all ranks under condition 1 is 24.5. We denote this by T1. And the sum of total ranks under condition 2 is 80.5. And that has been denoted by T2. And the sum of the ranks under condition 1 is smaller than the sum of the ranks under condition 2. And here the computation of mean has no more meaning. But for condition 1, the mean for the scores for the data set of condition 1 mean is 3.67 and for the scores of condition 2, 7.13. It has no more meaning for the interpretation of result, but just I am clarifying what exactly this figure stands for here. Okay, this is the point you have to focus here. Rank total for both conditions, condition 1 and condition 2. Dear friends, the aim of the U-test is to compare the rank totals in the two conditions based on overall ranking. If the rank difference okay, if the rank differences between the conditions are random as stated by the null hypothesis, there should be roughly equal ranks in the two conditions. But if there is a large difference of low or high ranks in one condition in the predicted direction, the difference between condition will justify the rejection of the null hypothesis. तो यहाँ पे मैं आपको दोबारा समझाने की कोशिश करता हूँ. यदि condition 1 और condition 2 में rank totals के बीच में difference ज़्यादा है तो null hypothesis reject होगा. लेकिन दोनों condition में rank totals के बीच में डिफरेंस मार्जिनल है, नॉमिनल है, ज्यादा डिफरेंस नहीं दिख रहा है, तो ऐसी स्थिति में आप नॉल हाइपोथेसिस को रिजेक्ट नहीं कर पाएंगे. टू रिजेक्ट द नॉल हाइपोथेसिस देयर शुड बी सिग्निफिकेंट डिफरेंस बिटवीन द रैंक टोटल्स ऑफ टू ग्रुप्स. दैट इज द क्राइटेरिया फॉर द रिजेक्शन ऑफ नॉल हाइपोथेसिस. एंड यू हैव टू नोट एंड रिकॉल दिस पॉइंट during data analysis. These are the sequential steps to be followed for the manual calculation of the U-test. During the computation of U-test, you have to compute U-value twice, that is U and U-dash. Just you have to understand this formula. To compute the U-value at first, you have to use this formula. U is equal to N1 times N2 plus N1 times N1 plus 1 by 2 minus T1. And let's try to understand the meaning of these abbreviations here. N1 stands for the number of participants in condition 1. N2 stands for the number of participants in condition 2. And T1 is the rank total for group 1. I mean for condition 1, and it has been abbreviated here, it has been detailed here. Just you can capture the peak of this slide for later memory and review. Of course, I am sharing my entire lecture in my YouTube channel. I think that will support you to review and recall later. And I advise you all to access this channel and go for review later on when required and necessary. Right? Okay. This is the formula. Let us substitute the values of N1, N2 and T1. Of course, the number of participants under condition 1 is 6, and that is 8 for condition 8, and the rank total for condition 1 is 24.5. We have already computed T1 and T2, I mean the rank totals for condition 1 and 2, And finally, after simplification, it comes 44.5. The value of u is 44.5. And you have to remember next formula for the computation of u dash. And u dash is equal to n1 times n2 minus u. Just you have to subtract the value of u from the n1, from the product of n1 and n2. And that is, 6 times 8 minus 44.5. This is u. And finally, it comes 3.5. Dear friends, to test the null hypothesis, you have to compare the value of u and u dash. And just you have to consider that value which is smaller. If we'll compare the value of u, u dash and u, clearly the value of u dash seems quite smaller, right? U is 44.5 and u dash is 3.5. I mean, if we'll start looking at the table to check the level of significance, you have to consider the smaller value of u, not this one, not 44.5. Just you have to consider 3.5. This is the one more thing you have to understand during the null hypothesis testing and looking at the table in your statistical, in the book of statistics. Okay, let's go ahead. Look at the table B1. I have already recommended the textbook to get the quick and simplified idea and computation of the parametric and non-parametric test. I have displayed this book in my second slide. Okay, how to look at the table B? That is important thing here. Of course, there are 6 participants in condition 1 and 8 participants in condition 2. And when you will start looking at the table B, you have to locate the figure 6 on the top horizontal row. And you have to locate the 8 in the extreme left vertical column. And you have to draw the diagonal, the one horizontal diagonal and one vertical diagonal. Then where these two diagonals will meet, that will be the critical value in your case. Just go ahead and let us try to look at the table. Yeah, I was just talking about the finding 6 on the top horizontal bar. This is 6. And of course, this is the number of participants for condition 1. And you have to locate the 8 in the vertical column of the extreme left, and just you draw the diagonal, horizontal diagonal from the 8 and vertical diagonal from the 6. And these two diagonals will meet on the 6. So just you compare this critical value with computed value. What was the smaller computed value of the u? Let's go back. 3.5 is the smallest, the smaller computed value of the u. So let us compare this 3.5 with this critical value 6. And obviously, the computed value 3.5 is smaller than the tabulated value. This implies the rejection of null hypothesis. And you have to be careful about one more thing here. Our research hypothesis has been said directional. So we'll look at the case of one tail, not two tail. If the level of significance for one tail is 0.01, that will be 0.02 in the case of two tail. But in this case, the set research hypothesis is directional one. So just look at here, the computed value of u, that is 3.5, is smaller as compared to the critical value of the table, that is 6, at level of significance 0.01, and this implies the rejection of null hypothesis. You can draw and write the conclusion in this way. It can be concluded that the prediction that participants will recall more of text when given an appropriate title was supported. I mean, research hypothesis has been supported by rejecting the null hypothesis. Null hypothesis says there will be equal recalling capacity between both conditions, but our research hypothesis has always predicted the students were given title before measuring the recall scores will recall more as compared to those who had not given the title. That was the research hypothesis, and that has been supported after the rejection of this null hypothesis. And this is the entire procedure for the calculation of the u-test and looking at the table to check whether null hypothesis is true or untrue. That was the table for level of significance 0.01, and this is the table for level of significance 0.005. I mean the 0.005 for one tail and 0.01 for two tail. I mean you have to look at the different tables for different level of significance. Let me check here too. Let's try to check or computed value is significant or not for level of significance 0.005. Okay, let us try to look at the 6 on the top horizontal bar, that is 6, and 8 in extreme left column. And you come here, let us come to the point of intersection, that is 10. Okay. Our computed value is also smaller as compared to the critical value for level of significance 0.005. Our computed value was 3.5, but critical value for the level of significance 0.005 is 10. So our null hypothesis also can be rejected for this level of significance too. But for data analysis, we'll be using the software. Software gives the exact level of significance by default. And we'll end the discussion for manual calculation of this parametric and non-parametric test. I'll just orient you people for the use of statistical software to compute this test too. In statistical software, you need not to look at these statistical tables to check the significance, whether null hypothesis is rejected or not. That will be given by default in the result. That greatly reduces the headache to look at the table and go for manual calculation as people used to do in previous times. Okay, this is the second example. I advise you all to capture the picture of this slide and go for self-calculation as your homework. Let me take a pause for a few seconds so that you will be able to capture the pic of this slide, and that has been given to you as a homework. Okay, friends, that was the all about the u-test. I think you might have understood the concept calculation and the procedure of looking at the statistical table, especially to know the whether set null hypothesis is true or false. Let us talk about the concept of t-test. T-test is a sort of parametric test. It's not non-parametric, it's parametric. T-test may be related, unrelated. I mean, t-test may be dependent, undependent. You note one thing hereby. The parametric equivalent of Wilcoxon test is pair t-test, and parametric equivalent of u-test is unpaired t-test. And this is the fundamental formula for the computation of t-test. T is equal to predicted variance due to independent variable divided by total variance due to all variables. This is the general principle and formula behind the computation of tree value. And what exactly predicted variance stands for here? Variance caused by the independent variable selected by the researcher is called the predicted variance. This is also called systematic variance in the term of research. Predicted variance is also called systematic variance. Let me simplify more. The variance caused by selected independent variable, the variance caused by the input, what you are giving as independent variable is called the predicted variance. And total variance accounts for both. Variance caused by independent variable and variance caused by chance factor. The variance caused by chance factors is called unpredicted variance. Total variance is equal to variance caused by independent variable and variance caused by chance factors. Variance caused by chance factors is called unpredicted variance. This is also called the error variance, right? So you should not be confused by the different terms, unpredicted variance, error variance, and the variance caused by chance factor, all are the same thing. Okay. I've already said these points. The t-test is the parametric equivalent for both Wilcoxon and u-test. Particularly, paired t-test is equivalent to Wilcoxon and unpaired t-test is equivalent to u-test. We have 15 minutes more, 14 minutes more. Okay. This is an example of related t-test. Dear friends, if we are talking about the use and calculation of the parametric test, particularly t-test, the level of measurement always should be of interval or ratio. If the measured data is not in interval and ratio scale, you cannot think of using t-test, right? And first we are discussing the case of related t-test. Related t-test is also called pair t-test, dependent t-test. These are the same terms to indicate the t-test in related design. Related t-test, pair t-test, dependent t-test. And obviously, at the same sample, we'll go through condition 1 and condition 2. This is also called repeated method design in statistics. Okay, here we are having 4 participants, 1, 2, 3, 4. and there are four participants under condition one, and again four participants, equal number of participants under condition two. Of course, this is the repeated measure design, and there is no chance of having unequal number of participants under condition one and condition two. I mean, the number of participants in both conditions will be always equal, being the repeated measure design, right? And for the computation of t value in case of related design, you have to compute the differences between the scores of condition 1 and condition 2. Let us start subtracting the scores of condition 2 from the scores of condition 1. 10 minus 5 plus 5, 8 minus 7 plus 1, 7 minus 10 minus 3, 3 minus 8 minus 5. And just we are going to square these differences to nullify the effect of plus and minus sign. The square of plus 5, 25, and the square of plus 1, plus 1, and the square of minus 3 is 9, and the square of minus 5 is 25. And we are denoting the square of differences by d square. This is the procedure of calculating differences between the data points of condition 1 and condition 2. ये मैंने आपको पहले बता दिया, आपके पास एक ही सैंपल है, एक ही सैंपल से दो डेटा सेट जनरेट हुआ आपने किया है, और आपके जो आपका डिपेंडेंट वेरिएबल है उसका लेवल ऑफ मेजरमेंट इंटरवल या रेशियो लेवल की है, तब आपको पीआरटी टेस्ट लगानी चाहिए। और हाइपोथेसिस टेस्टिंग के लिए जो आपको एडवांस में चीज तय करनी चाहिए वो ये है कि आपके रिसर्च हाइपोथेसिस, आई मीन अल्टरनेटिव हाइपोथेसिस, वन टेल है या टू टेल है। अगर वन टेल है तो आपको टेबल उस हिसाब से देखना पड़ेगा, टू टेल है तो आपको टू टेल में देखना पड़ेगा। मैं आपको बार बार ये बात बता चुका हूँ, तो आपको हाइपोथेसिस की टेस्ट वन टेल में करना है, टू टेल में करना है, दैट शुड बी डिसाइडेड इन एडवांस बिफोर रनिंग द स्टैटिस्टिकल टेस्ट एंड मोर प्रिसाइसली ड्यूरिंग द कंप्यूटेशन एंड जस्टिफिकेशन ऑफ द सैंपल साइज, इट शुड बी ऑलरेडी डिसाइडेड। दिस इज द रिसर्च केस सैंपल डेटा for which we are going to look at the data points and computation of the related t value. Okay, all participants were given 2 minutes to read a simple text and a complex text. After 10 minutes, they were asked to recall the words to counterbalance possible order effects of doing both conditions. Half of the participants were presented with the simple text first, and the other half with complex test first. I think you might be familiar about the concept of self as a control design. This is also called counterbalance design in research. You have been going through the sessions of the research methodology too. That is a part of research design, right? Just, you know, if we are talking about the case of related design, there always happens the use of counterbalancing technique to nullify the order effects. Just in our case, let us look at the table. We are having the 10 participants, and they are supposed to go through both condition A and condition 2. Just we have randomly selected 5 participants out of 10 and have made them to go through condition 1 and condition 2. I mean, at first, out of 10, 5 participants are going through condition 1 and 5 participants are going condition through 2. and these are the associated scores for all participants for condition 1 and condition 2, and this is the column to show the differences among the data points of condition 1 and condition 2, 10 minus 2, 8, 5 minus 1, 4. Okay. After computing the differences between the data points for condition 1 and condition 2, we have to square the differences to avoid the effect of plus and minus sign. And lastly, we are totaling the square differences, and it comes around 1.151. And the sum of the rank differences is 27, and the total of the squared differences is 151. Okay, this is the new and important formula for you people to note and remember for the manual calculation of pure t value. T is equal to sigma d whole upon under root n sigma d square minus sigma d whole squared by n minus 1. These are the simple mathematical notations. Already you know the meaning of them. Sigma stands for total, right? And this is the sign of square root. And let us substitute the values of concerned term. T is equal to, what is sigma d? Let's go back. Sigma d is equal to 27, and total number of participants in this case is 10, that is 10, and the value of sigma d squared is equal to 151, and sigma d is 27, sigma d whole square, 27 whole square. When you will go through simplification, and finally it comes to 0.89. In the case of related t test, the degree of freedom is equal to total number of participants minus 1, and the total number of participants is 10 minus 1 is equal to 9. In this case, the degree of freedom is 9. And let us go how to look at the statistical table to know the whether computed t-value is significant or not. Whether the computed t-value is capable to reject null hypothesis or not. This is the t-table. In the test statistical book, I recommended you. This table is given under table C. And of course, in this case, we are taking the directional research hypothesis, so I have to look at the level of significance in the case of one tail. This is the degree of freedom. Just you go along this column and try to find out this 9 degree of freedom. It's 9, and first you check the level of significance at 0.10 level. It's 1.383. So computed t value is greater than this. So of course, null hypothesis can be rejected at this level. Let us go to the next smaller level, that's 0.05. Again, the computed t value, what is this? 2.89. This is the computed t-value, t.89 is again greater than the 1.833. Let us go to the next smaller level of significance, and the computed t-value is again greater than this value. So this hints us to go the next smaller level of significance, and 2.89 is again greater than this, but smaller than this. So, our null hypothesis can be rejected at the 0.01 level of significance. I mean, what is the point statistical statement for the rejection of null hypothesis? Computed t value 2.89 is greater than 2.82 at level of significance 0.01 for d of 9. This hints that null hypothesis is rejected by accepting the point made by research hypothesis. Yes, this is the same thing expressed in the language. I've already told this point. The calculated t has to be greater than the values in table C. You need to use the t of 9 to find the value. Yeah, I've already explained this point in simple term. I think you get this point. So let me repeat one point here. In case of U test and Wilcoxon test, the computed value should be smaller than critical value to reject the null hypothesis. But in case of T test, it's totally reverse. The computed value should be greater than the value taken from the table. I mean, the computed value should be greater than the critical value to reject the null hypothesis. That is the reverse concept to reject the null hypothesis in case of parametric and non-parametric. That's all about tip today. And let me report one more point here. And Pierre T test is, of course, parametric equivalent of Wilcoxon test. If you are having data of ordinal nature, you have to think of line Wilcoxon. But if your data is in interval or ratio level, you have to use the Pierre T test. That's all about today. I am skipping this slide and opening the floor for question and answers.
Om sir, thank you sir for your explanation. This is Akshay. I had a question, sir. Could you please explain me the in the previous slide today you have talked about the Mann-Whitney U test. So in that one of the